No. In the last class, we were discussing about the memory systems, that is read-only memory and read-write memory. So under read-only memory, we once again gone through the flash memory and ROM and one-time programmable memory, OTP, or masked ROM. Right. So, and difference between OTP and EPROM and EEPROM, and these were the different types of memory in read-only memory. Coming to read-write memory, which is also called as random access memory. So, random access memory are those which are controlled by your processors or controllers. So, to increase the performance of a processor, RAM plays a very important role. The higher the RAM, so faster the execution. And of course, once again in RAM, we have two different types of RAM. One is SRAM and another one is DRAM. So SRAM is always S stands for static RAM and D stands for dynamic RAM. We understood that this static RAM contains 6 transistors to store 1 bit of memory, whereas dynamic RAM requires a single NMOS transistor to store 1 bit of memory, and it is going to be stored in the fashion of capacitor charging and discharging. As long as the capacitor have a charge, it stores the value. The moment it discharges, the value get lost. So that's why we call that RAM, dynamic RAM always requires a power backup. So hence, you can also consider that the DRAM is your the memory. What is that like? The 4 GB RAM of your PCs or 8 GB RAM of your mobile phones. We also understood one small concept called this one, memory shadowing. And today we will start with a new topic, that is sensors and actuators. So, sensors and actuators. Sensors, what do you mean by sensors? Once again, sensors are nothing but transducers. the main job of transducer. Sensor is a transducer, first thing, and transducer job is to convert one energy, the converts energy from one form to another form, which can be a measurement or for a control purpose. And most of the times, these sensors are made up of a simple RLC circuits. I think few of the sensors you might have also studied in your or about to study in your automotive systems. Just as a definition, here we are concentrating on how a sensor and actuators are interfaced to the controllers. Okay, so we are not going much in depth about sensors. So basically, a sensor is a transducer which converts one energy in the form of another energy. Maybe mainly it will convert a signal to an electrical signal. That's it. So whereas I supposed to assume that the temperature sensor, it recognizes the temperature and that value will be converted into electrical signals. So only electrical signals are understood by your hardware. So hence, in that perspective, the transducer converts that value that is going to be sensed into the electrical signal. Say for example, your mic. So wherein mic is, once again I call it as a transducer, which converts, well, the mic also consists of a transducer which converts your voice signal into electrical signal, right? So this is the importance of any transducer. And what about actuators? Once I sense the data from input, then again it has to be it should provide me some motion form of output, or the output I always expect to be the form of mechanical operation or some electrical operation. Say for example, in a home automation, so a person enters into the home, so there will be a sensor which recognizes a person entering into this room. Then I will be having some appliances to be controlled. Say for example, I should turn on the light, okay, based upon the intensity of the room, whether it is dark or whether it is having some light. So which means that there must be an actuator. Based on the sensor input, it has to perform some job, and here what operation it has to perform. Say for example, turning on the light, I call it as one. Now which means that if I want to turn on the light, what type of signal it is to be what type of output signal we are expecting? It is nothing but an electrical signal, right? So this job is nothing but this job is performed by actuator. Similarly, taking another example, say for example, if I want to turn on or rotate the fan, so rotation of fan is something like performing a mechanical operation, right? So there will be a small motor in a fan and I need to turn on the motor. There may be a DC motor here, right? So definitely not a stepper motor. So DC motor will be there. I turn on that DC motor and in turn, based on my input signal, sensed signal, so DC motor will start rotating. And here the DC motor is an actuator. Okay, DC motor is actuator. That's for, once again, actuator is a form of transducer which converts a mechanical or electrical signals into physical motion, right? So once again, actuators are always used as a output device. Sensors are always used as a input device. Sensors are an input and actuators are output. So you can consider this a system or a controller controller. Input to the controller is sensor, and output from the controller I give it to actuator, and actuator may be a DC motor or maybe a stepper motor as such. Okay. Now the third point is I/O subsystem. What you mean by I/O system? Say for example, maybe all time I may not rely on sensor input. Sometimes it so happen like my microcontroller expects some input from the user. Now what type of input he may expect, and I need to have the output in another fashion. Now let me assume that I am trying to dial a number from my landline telephone numbers. So I consider this to be some numbers here. So 1 to 9 and 0, whatever the telephone keypad consists of. Now this is a keypad of my telephone. Now I press number 1, 2, 3, 4 or some mobile number I will try to dial. Now at the output, how it is going to understood the same numbers are going to be it has to be decoded, because microcontroller, once again, it understands only the binary language. Then this value I am trying to feed it as an input to my microcontroller, and I want to get it displayed first whether I am trying to dial the same numbers as I kept. Now, sometimes it may happen like I may type a wrong numbers also, right? So if I want to write like some telephone numbers, and the telephone equivalent number supposed to be displayed on my LCD screen. Now these two, that is keypad unit and the LCD unit, are called as input output subsystems. Okay, here to perform automated option, I don't have any sensors, I don't have any actuators to decide based on my input, sensed input. So there are some other situations where I need to consider another subsystems, wherein those subsystems are connected to my microcontroller or the processors to perform some job. So here keypad acts as a input device. LCD display is acting like a output device. So hence the I/O subsystem of embedded system facilitates the interaction of embedded system with the external world. So this is the importance of sensors, actuators and I/O subsystem. So we are today in this class, we will try to discuss few subsystems, how it works, and one actuator like stepper motor. Okay, so this is as per your syllabus. Now what is this LED interfacing, light emitting diode interfacing? Why do we require? So I just, as I told you, in a lab, the very good example, we have worked with a relay to turn on the relay. Now whether the relay is turned on or turned off, that I want to notice. So how do you notice that? So I will keep one of the LED as a subsystem, which is a output device, right? So or else another, this is just nothing but a visualized indication or indication that will be giving about the subsystem. So say for example, I need to know that whether a key is pressed or not. Say for example, there will be a keyboard interface to my microcontroller here. So I will be having one small switch. I press this. How do I come to know that this switch is pressed or not? So in that perspective, I take the help of LED or a light emitting diode. I take this help. If this switch is pressed, the LED will glow. If it is not pressed, the LED will be turned off. So that's where it is used to indicate, it is used to indicate like device turned on or not. Or the other very good example is when you charge your mobile phones, then you need to have a small indication of charging, right? So that's where again, in order to get that such small indications, this will be used. And technically speaking, okay, whenever a switch is pressed, so assume that whenever a switch is pressed, so switch will be something like this. Switch will be something like this. Whenever you press this, okay, you press this switch, the 5 volts or whatever the voltage is there, that will be gone through this, and this will be a closed circuit. Once it is a closed circuit, so obviously the output LED will glow. So very simple and straightforward, and this is the first subsystem, and which is nothing but a output device. Next important here it is optocoupler. So optocoupler is once again a output device. So optocoupler combines two devices. One is LED, IO interface LED, so which consists of LED and a photo transistor. So optocoupler is used for suppressing the interface in data communication, and it is used in current circuit isolation. Say for example, if I assume that if there is a huge current is getting passed to any system, I want to cut that isolation, I want to go for making that stop that operation. Now for which a photo transistor will be helping out. So again, for the indication about that huge current flow, so LED will be helping out. So in this circuit, the job of that optocoupler will help us in a much efficient way. So this is how for any microcontroller, the arrangement of optocoupler is made. So if at all it is asked in the examination, you are supposed to write this diagrams and just explain the importance of importance and applications of these optocoupler and any output devices. Okay, now the third important output device or the subsystem, IO subsystem, is 7-segment display. Once again, this is already discussed in your regular class as a part of your lab. So this is what a 7-segment display, how it looks in your lab, any of the circuit. So when I look into this, so these individual lines are nothing but a diodes. What type of this one? It is configured as in the form of light emitting diodes. Maybe these diodes are connected to common anode, or these diodes are connected to common cathode. That's where sometimes to turn on we will be using logic 0, or sometimes we will be using logic 1. So that is depend upon your the common anode LED display or common cathode LED display, right? So if at all I want to turn on our specific device, so this information of whether it is common anode or common cathode we'll get to know through the manual of the hardwares. So you need to go through the database of that particular manual, then only we understood whether it is a common anode and common cathode. Now say for example, if you want to display one, so it is nothing but here I should give one and one, and rest of the signal will be zero. So this is how we performed, and we also wrote a C programming to display numbers from 1 to F, right? So you can display hexadecimal count from 0 to, not 1, from 0 to F, totally 16 values or 15 values you can count. So 7 segment LED once again is an output device for displaying alphanumeric characters. And where do you use these kinds of displays? Where do we use? So earlier days where we had a public telephone booth or 1 rupee coin, okay, 1 rupee coin, wherein normally public telephone booth consisting of rates. I think you might have aware of that or not. So when during our engineering days, whenever we want to call back to our home, and we used to go for STD, and STD, where the moment I dial to a number, and the moment the other party receives the phone, it starts giving me the number, what is that, rate of that particular charges of that particular call rates used to get displayed. And in order to display that, whether it starts jumping for every minute from 1 rupee, 2 rupee, 3 rupee, if I spoke for 5 minutes, almost 5 rupees it is to charge during those days. So and that display is going to be provided through the LED displays. And yes, of course, even you can observe these kinds of LED seven segment displays in railway stations to know about a coach, okay, whether it is S5 or S6 kind of coach. So all there you can observe these kinds of the seven segment displays. And programming is quite easy here. Right, you can also display number as well as alphabets. All kinds of alphabets can be displayed from A to Z. So that's where in our college at the entrance itself we have put a long the seven segment display, wherein it gives you welcome to SDM CET message, right? So these kinds of programming is done when, and it is also alt. It can be easily altered. The program can be altered as and when it is required. Okay. Now, so these are all about this one. What is it? I/O interface. One more I/O interface. I'll come back to stepper motor later case. This is keyboard scanner or keypad scanner, we call it as. Now, how this keypad scanner works actually, right? So this is how, let me take, this is a same keypad that we use for our landline telephone numbers, wherein this will be having 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and so on, right? 8, right? So assume this is how it looks. Now, if I press a number like this 6, if I press this particular number, how a microcontroller will get to know that I have pressed 6 itself? Okay, let me take only this particular line here. So this is 6. Okay, now if I press this, how it get to know? Look at the circuit diagram. You can observe there are 4 rows and 4 columns. So totally in general we call this as a 4x4 keypad matrix. 4x4 keypad matrix. So 4x4 keypad matrix, which is once again a what type of interface? It is nothing but a input interface for the system. Now when I press this value, based upon the keypad, the arrangement may differ here. Like if you turn in another way, I can make this column to row and row to column, which means that row and columns can be interchangeable. Okay, now look at the column side. All columns are connected to VCC, which means that these lines across the column 0, column 1 and column 2, column 3 must possess the logic 1, right? So all are at 1, 1, 1 by default. Okay. Now assume that if I press this, so this will be a closed circuit what happens to here? What happens to here? So if I press this, this signal will be blown to logic 1, which means that row is also 1, right? So once again, when I release this, so the momentary you press this, so it will come to know that if I press this, okay, by default there will be one here, by default there will be one here. The moment if I press this, so I'll get to know that this signal is going to be turned on. So this is how a keypad scanner is going to be executed, right? So this is how it is going to understand about this particular line. Okay, so during that time, this will be 1 1 1 1 and this will be 0 0 0 0 by default. The moment I press this, so this row becomes 1, and because of which I'll get to know that either of this will be turned on. Either this signal will be turned on, or this signal will be turned on, or this signal will be turned on, or this signal will be turned on. But the moment you release this, so there will be a fluctuation across the column side also. These are always the input port. So any signal that is to be given, these will be a input port. Okay. So regarding stepper motor, there are two types of stepper motor. Maybe a unipolar or bipolar. This is the example for unipolar, where the unipolar stepper motor consisting of only two windings. Windings means the coil. Coil windings will be having two windings, or maybe a bipolar means, so we'll going to get this four windings here. This is two phase polar, unipolar. Now again, in the stepper motor, we already know that there will be consisting of coil A, coil B, coil C and coil D, and simultaneously we try to energize two successive coils, right? So the moment you turn on this coil and this coil, so what happens to this? If you observe the circuit diagram, so this will be energized, and parallelly, because of B is turned on, this coil is getting energized. So because of this energy, it tried to move in a clockwise direction. So once again, if look at this, this is 1100. So 1100 is nothing but, it is 12 in this one, so you can consider like 8421. And next I go for shifting that value, so B is energized. So next C will be energized, so this will be go off. So next, if you observe here, this will be 0110. Okay, so therefore this becomes 6. Okay, now once again, this is energized, C is energized, so I will energize the next successive coil, that is D. So C and D get energized, so which means that 0011, so it is again 3 here. Okay, now after once A is D is energized, the next coil is A. So therefore D and A get energized, so this will be 9. So that's where we try to put this value 12639 in lab to execute or to turn on the stepper motors constantly. So this is all about, and this is how a stepper motor, now stepper motor I call this as an actuator, okay. This is how it try to connect with the input ports, coil A, coil B, coil C, coil D. So this is a microcontroller. Microcontroller, the four output ports, the four output ports will be connected to these coils in turn. So there is a interfacing driver called ULN2806, because we will be sending this with very less voltage, approximately 5 volts. But to turn on this, at least I require a minimum of 12 volts supply. So hence what we do, we use ULN2803, a driver which drives my stepper motor at higher voltage. So this is how the interfacing of stepper motor with controller is done. Probably in the lab we will not use this IC, because nowadays, as I told you, because of system on chip process, this entire chip will be present in my the LPC2148 board itself. Okay, if you observe carefully, after this beside this connection stepper motor, there will be a small IC which is ULN2803 IC on board itself. You can able to see this. Okay, so this is all about the stepper motors as an actuator and different IO boards. Okay, so today we will stop here. So today we discussed about very simple and very straightforward concepts. There is no much technical details to be discussed here. Only thing is, you need to know the importance of IO subsystems and sensors and as a part of actuator. Okay, so in the next class we will go for the last topic of this chapter, that is communication interface. That is, we will discuss about UART and I2C bus. I hope if you have any doubts, let me know. So I think I have not uploaded this particular textbook in the Google Classroom. By today afternoon, I'll try to upload this textbook in the this one. I'll try to upload the same. And there is one small announcement here. Next Monday, that is 24th, the CTA activity, we will be conducting a CTA activity, like first quiz for CTA activity, like quiz for both the divisions. Even Jayashree ma'am and myself will be posting you the quiz. So this quiz is compulsory for all of you to have a CTA assessment of 10 marks. So this is not only one quiz, this is first quiz. Maybe one more CTA assessment will be chosen. Okay, maybe a assignment or a quiz, that also we are not at sure of that. We'll let you know as and when. Now for syllabus for this quiz is unit 1 to up to 3. Unit 1 to 3. So from unit 1 to unit 3, we'll try to conduct the quiz. Be prepared for that. And timing, we will let you know. Probably once you finish your classes in the afternoon, and probably we'll start at 4:30 onwards. Okay. Any doubts? So quiz announcement is done and syllabus is also discussed, and we also uploaded unit 3 questions, question bank in Google Classroom. I want each one of you to prepare the answer for all the three units. Hardly 24 questions, each unit consisting of 8 questions, 8 into 3, 24 questions. Prepare answers for all the questions, okay, and upload it in Google Classroom. Fine, or else, okay, don't worry, I will create a separate link and there you can upload. Okay, you take anyways, unit 1 and unit 3 are covered. Unit 1 and 2 all for completely covered. Unit 3 till 7th questions you have covered. Only we left with only 8th question. By that time you can start writing the answers for each one of that. And yesterday I also shared the marks, IA marks. If anyone is having any doubts, please let me know. Okay. Thank you. You can leave the meet. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Abhishek. Abhishek, are you there?